talked about some of the cases that still haunt you and remembering those, particularly the Navin case. Maybe that's the most important one to you, maybe not. Do you have one that was the strangest for you?
They're all strange in their own way. You're correct. The Navin case was the last case, major case that I was involved with. That was probably the most disturbing because they're people that I knew personally, and they're also were best friends with my sister and her husband, so I used to see them at their house regularly. And I also knew Kyle Navin because Kyle Navin, we mentored him a little bit when he was just out of high school. He wanted to be a police officer, and he came and did ride-alongs with the police department with a lot of the guys. So the guys all knew him. So it was a tragedy on many levels. But again, going back to when I was talking about these tragedies that you have to be able to vent with each other and then hopefully compartmentalize them and put them on a shelf somewhere so that you don't have to deal with it, you know. I always tell people that there is only so much shelf space that a police officer has to be able to put these things compartmentalized up on the shelf before the shelf starts getting overburdened. And that's when you know that an officer is starting to suffer burnout. Mm-hmm. The chief of police has the same things happen. They suffer burnout, especially after a total of 36-year career. I think my shelf was pretty full. I don't have any regrets. I mean, I think, like the old song, you know, regrets I have a few, but then again, too few to mention. I mean, I think that I was able to accomplish most of the things I set out to accomplish. I think the town of Weston is a very safe place to live. I just moved here last year. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else.
What was your strangest case? Were you here when they tarred and feathered the guy?
That was a couple of years before I started. I remember Bruce Turner used to talk about it, yeah. But he owed some money to a loan shark or something.
Yeah, exactly, and he disappeared from the hospital once they found
him
there.
Yeah, he showed up on the front of the town hall, tarred and feathered.
Yeah.
He owed a loan shark. Yeah, that was a couple of years before I started, but I do remember that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so yeah, we've definitely had some strange things happen here in town.
Such as? After that? During your time as an officer in chief?
Well, I mean, she says strange, I say tragic. I mean, they're kind of like one and the same in a lot of ways. You know, we've had all sorts of tragedies, and I tell the story, you know, I drive around this town and I see ghosts, I see them all the time, just like in that movie, The Sixth Sense. You know, I can drive by any neighborhood, any town, any part of town where I remember where there was a fatal accident, where there was a motorcycle accident, fatality, where there was a suicide, where there was a domestic violence situation, where there was any litany of things that were all tragic. One of the reasons we bought this house is because in 36 years I'd never had a call here. So, but, you know, I think strange, tragic, I mean, they're all one and the same. I think, for a police officer anyway, I think, too, there are those incidents where you find that you've actually helped somebody, which I had a girl come looking for me one time, and she's like, I wanted to thank you. I'm like, thank me for what? And she's like, well, you, 10 years ago, you sat there and you read me the riot act and you told me that, you know, I was acting like a slut and that, you know, I was supposed to be a lady. And I'm like, I said that, and she goes, yeah, but I want to thank you for saying that to me, because after I left there, I said, you know what, he's right, and I changed. And, you know, this is 10 years later, she was in her mid-20s, and she was showed up to thank me for reading her the riot act one time, you know. And I had other situations, too, where people would come to me and say, I run into this gentleman in town every once in a while. He says, hey, my son told me to say hi to you. I'm like, why? Who are you? He goes, don't you remember you called me up in the middle of the night and I went over to that house where my son was sleeping over with a bunch of other kids and they had, like, run over a bunch of mailboxes and you found his car with the damage and you called me to come there because you wouldn't admit that he did it, and I told you to throw the handcuffs on him in front of his friends, and you did. I'm like, oh yeah, I remember that. He goes, my son, after that, after you did that, he says he was changed. He's a changed person. Now he's living down in Georgia. He's got his own company. And he said that congratulations to be the chief of police. And if you never run into him again, please tell him I said hi. I'm like, wow, you know, right. Little things like that, you know.
Was there any pattern to the crime in Weston, or was it just sort of random stuff?
I think you're talking about pattern. I think there's trends. I think when I first started, the big trend at that time was burglaries, breaking and enterings, and we had a lot of burglaries. And whenever it seemed to be the same people that would come into town. I remember I was working with Bruce Turner one time when we ended up apprehending somebody that we charged with burglary, and you know, we went and arrested him. He was like, where are you guys from? And we're like, we're from Weston. He goes, I never did any burglaries in Weston. He thought he was in Westport doing it. He didn't even know Weston existed. You know, he thought he was in Westport. So we had trends with burglaries. You know, we, as far as fatal accidents or motor vehicle accidents, those types of things, we usually about every 3 years we have a fatality. That's been the norm. Sometimes you go a little bit longer. Those are always tragic. Identity theft now is a big deal because now the criminals have figured out they don't have to break into your house to get stuff. They can break into your social media and they can acquire information from you, and then they can go and steal your identity and purchase things, or you know, they can do things with your credit and get credit cards and stuff like that. So they don't have to break into your house to get money anymore. So I think that's a big trend now. So, you know, police departments are trying to deal with that. And that's a training issue as well.
Have drugs become a problem in Weston? Do any
I would say that drugs have probably always been a problem in this town. I think there have been different levels of the problem. When I was in high school, there were a certain group of people that used to smoke pot, and they would, once in a while, they would drop acid, you know, would hear about it. But that was usually just a small group of, we used to call them the freaks, you know. I think the thing that's happened nowadays is, you know, anybody can be a drug addict. And, you know, I think that's the tragedy of it now. It's like there are kids that have, you know, and not specifically in Weston, but just nationally, who have been injured on, say, the football field. And they are given painkillers by their doctors, and they're overprescribed the painkillers, and they get addicted to the painkillers, and then they take the painkillers away, and then they have this addiction, and the closest thing to the painkiller that's even cheaper than the painkiller is the heroin and the opioids. So I think what the trend now, and again, it has a lot to do with education. I think we have to, you know, I think that we have to educate our doctors as well as to what's caused this opioid, you know, epidemic. And you know, we've had overdoses here in town. There's somebody who's still in a coma because of it, and they arrested three people that were involved with supplying him, with the opioids, who have pled guilty and are doing time. But the opioid epidemic is part of what happened at the Navin case too. And that's a sad thing, that Kyle Navin apparently had become addicted to heroin.
Yeah.
Same thing, he had a back injury and was given painkillers, and then when those were no longer available, he ended up on heroin. Mm-hmm. And the end result of that is a big tragedy. I've been told by investigators of the state police that were involved with that case that they've seen this thing, you know, this drug situation with the opioids and with the heroin and everything, it's driven people that were, you know, absolute normal, wonderful people to this crazed, you know, murder and burglaries and thefts and doing things that they would not normally do. One of the big TV shows series that's very popular now is called The Walking Dead. I don't know if you've seen any of the thing. I think we're living with that type of a thing. We're living with people who are kind of the walking dead that get addicted to these drugs, and they're just like zombies going around and stealing and, you know, and getting into these situations, and it's a sad case.
Is that what most of the teenage crime is these days? Is more drugs? Or, I mean, they don't seem to be
There are a whole litany of things that happen, and we have in town, we have a forensic computer crime lab that's very, very active with the child pornography issues, you know, because, you know, social media and these cell phones, it's so easy to, these kids taking a picture of their girlfriend naked and all of a sudden they're sharing it with all their friends, and suddenly it's child porn is being distributed. You know, we have a lot of identity theft crimes and different crimes that have to do with, you know, forensic analysis through these computers that that we've been taking on here in town, which is a big thing now. Mm-hmm. And I think you're going to see that crime, that kind of fashion of crime, is going more in that direction the more the technology gets more complex.
You also mentioned domestic disputes. Has been an increase of that over time? How often does this happen in Weston?
I think what you notice in Weston specifically is when the financial state of the town kind of gets into a jam, like nationally. I mean, you get into a recession, and I think nationally you see that there are more domestic situations because a lot of it has to do with financial strife. When things are good and the money's coming in and you can pay all of your bills, people get along better. When things get things financially get difficult with people, I think that you start seeing the relationship kind of erode. And maybe these people weren't, you know, the best of friends to begin with, but when the money was coming in, things were good. But then when the money dries up and there's a recession, I think that you see more domestic violence situations than you normally do. But again, that's a trend too. I mean, we've had always had domestics in this town, but those are things that aren't normally reported to the local newspaper. The local newspaper initially wasn't the least bit interested in that. I think they are more now. There are laws that make the police officer the complainant when it comes into those situations. So you no longer, you know, rely on the victim to make the complaint against the aggressor. If you see evidence of physical violence, the officer has to make an arrest. One of the problems that we have dealings with is, you know, sometimes you end up making a dual arrest because there's evidence of physical violence on the female but also on the male. And then they tend to blame each other for the, you know, who hit who first, so you get into this dual arrest thing. So that's something that you know, the courts are trying to deal with and trying to set kind of guidelines to avoid the dual arrest, because then the victim then, you know, gets into the system and doesn't really get the assistance that they need because they also are seen as the aggressor.
Are there hate crimes in Weston?
I don't know that we specifically ever dealt with any real hate crimes. I think there have been, over the years, swastikas painted on the school, that type of stuff, graffiti type things. But as far as a hate crime, you know, somebody being, you know, assaulted or something like that for their religious belief or, you know, what nationality they are or something like that, I don't think we've had to deal with too much of that I can recall in town. I know that there are things that happen peripherally. I think there was something recently that happened in Westport, you know, with the swastikas and stuff like that. A lot of that, I think, though, you know, you have to take it seriously, but a lot of it just has to do with, I think, youths that don't understand history, and they think it's funny, and they, when they draw a swastika, not really understanding the ramifications of it, like maybe people of our generation do, that we've been educated in what that all means. But you, of course, you have to take it seriously. Any threat now, you have to take seriously.
Hopefully the town gave its collective thanks to you for a job well done. I think they did.
Yeah, I got some stuff to show you.
Okay.
That they, yeah.
Okay. And
I think the most important part of that, I will say, is, you know, not that I had a big party or anything like that, because I didn't really want that. But I think that the most important thing for me to understand, to appreciate, is the fact that anyone that I run into around town from the general public thanks me for my service. Mm-hmm. And that's the real thing that is appreciated.
Than that.
Yeah. That's and you know, I might show up at the library to return a book for my wife or something like that. Well, oh, you're Chief Trox. I'm like, no, I'm John Trox. I used to be the chief of police. Oh, well, thank you for your service. Or a mm-hmm. Weston Center, people, you know, say thank you for your service. Right. Thank you for the service to the town. And I hope you're enjoying retirement, mm-hmm. which I am.
Good. You said you hadn't met the new fellow, so you didn't have any, you know, response to him being hired. But did you give any advice to the police commission on what you thought would
be a good person? No, I have been totally out of the loop with that, which, you know, I feel like when you retire,
you should be, yeah.
You're really... it's really your time to cut the cord.
Mm-hmm.
In a lot of ways, it's refreshing to do that, because I will say again, as a chief of police, you really don't have any friends like from the police department or from the mm-hmm. town government. You really don't. I mean, you have people you've had to deal with or you've had to work with or you have worked with on a certain level, but you know, you find that your friends are in the general public. So me severing my relationship with the chief's office and everything that goes along with that was important to me. And I'm at the point in my life now where I'm trying to kind of recreate myself, you know, reinvent myself. My grandfather who came here, my mother's father, John Taschel, who came here from Austria when he was only in his early 20s, back in 1921, after the First World War. He came here by himself. He was stuck on Ellis Island for like 3 weeks because he was sick. And they almost sent him back, but he ended up staying. And he was able to reinvent himself numerous times in his life. And he was always very proud of that. And he said after he retired, he was an engineer. He used to engineer mechanical parts with Gleason Works in Rochester, New York. And when he retired from that, he didn't want to have anything to do with that ever again. And he just wanted to reinvent himself. And he became a gardener, an avid gardener. He would help, you know, people that came here from Austria or Germany. He would help them learn how to speak English. And one of the stories he told me one time was that there was this young girl that came from Germany, and you know, she was having a hard time acclimating to the United States, and she was having a hard time with the language, and she was like, you know, I'm going to give up. I wish I could go back to Germany, and he basically said to her, look, you're an American now. Start thinking like an American. Germany is your past. America is your future. So forget it and move forward. And he said from that point on, the girl was able to really establish herself and start learning the language, but you know, she was being held back somehow, but he gave her his little talking to, which was helpful. But
we could use his philosophy right now.
I'm looking forward to reinventing myself, and there are already opportunities that have come my way that are completely different than, I never want to manage people again. I never want to wear a uniform again. And I want to do something totally outside my realm of what I ever thought I was going to be able to do, and I want it to be fun. And so far, something has come up recently that I start tomorrow with a friend of mine has a garage in Wilton that he's had been running for 30 years with his son now. And he wants me to come in and work on his Facebook page, get that up to date, and his website. And he wants me, and I don't know anything about auto mechanics, I mean, I have office hands, which people make fun of, you know, because my hands have no calluses.
But you realize this is full circle from the parking lot.
Exactly.
The kids with their cars. Cruising the streets of Westport, and now you're going back to being hanging out
at Right, and it's actually with a friend of mine that I used to do all that stuff with. So, and he was like, he was the one that kind of saw it in me, like, I really think that you could be helpful to my business. You could be somebody that could come in here and work on our Facebook page, because I told him my experience with the police department Facebook page. I used to answer, people would like write to the website, I would respond immediately, you know, on my cell phone, and even people would write things on Facebook, I would respond in like almost in real time. And that's what he wants with his, because he doesn't have anyone that has the time to do that. They're all trying to do auto mechanics and deal with the customers. So he offered me a position, at least to start off part-time, to see if we both like the situation, and I think it's going to work out great.
That sounds wonderful.
Yeah, so kind of coming full circle again.
Right, exactly.
You know, and I like being around all of that, like the smell of oil and the smell and all of that stuff, and watching guys wrenching on cars and stuff like that. I don't want to do it, but I want to watch it. Like the TV shows now that I watch are all like on Velocity Television. It's like Iron Resurrection and Chasing Classic Cars and all of this stuff, you know.
Jay Leno's Garage?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you want to get the calluses, but you might just want to watch.
Who knows? Something completely different.
Talk about legacy for a minute. First of all, professionally, how do you see your legacy to the town of Weston as a police officer and police chief?
I think it's a... I'm trying to think how to say this. I think it's a, it could be a feel-good movie. I think it, you know, the hometown boy gets, you know, who has some problems when he's in his teen years with the police, and then suddenly becomes part of that police force at a young age, and then graduates through from a patrolman to, you know, a union president, PBA president, then becomes a sergeant, then becomes an interim chief, then becomes the chief of police for 10 years. I think it's almost like, to me, it almost seems like an unreal Disney movie. I think my legacy is remains to be seen. I think that people appreciate things after they don't have them anymore. I think that you know, this new chief has some hills to climb coming in.
Examples?
No, I just think that... he comes from the state police, which in itself I think is an interesting choice for the police commissions, because back in 1975 they decided to move away from the state police and create their own police department because they didn't like the state police philosophy of sorts, and they didn't feel that they didn't want the resident state trooper anymore with constables. They wanted to have their own police department with their own control, and a small town police department philosophy, mentality, which I just think, I'm not going to say anything negative about it, but I just think it's an interesting choice that the police commission made, bringing a lieutenant colonel from the state, Connecticut State Police, in as the next chief.
Let's go back to your legacy for a moment. Mm-hmm. What were the things that you were able to accomplish that changed policing in Weston?
My number one issue and concern was police training, not just with the equipment they had, but also going forward, being able to acquire more equipment that I felt was needed, and also the training for that. So I was always big about training. I was the department training officer for 3 or 4 years, and I was always sending people to advanced training. A lot of the training that some of the officers went to for this computer forensics, I was actively involved with helping them do that. And I got the approval from the police commission to send more people to that, which I thought was important in this day and age, to kind of stay ahead of, or at least stay up with, the crime trends that are going on. I think that my legacy is going to be what people remember me as being, always speaking what I felt was important. I never held back on, if I felt it was important to have certain things or to do certain things, I was always very vocal about it. I know I ruffled feathers you know, with some of the politicos in town, and it, you know, rub people the wrong way, getting the assault rifles, getting the Humvees, getting the tasers, all of these things. But now it's all kind of like accepted. You know, the officers carry these things on a daily basis, and I think it makes the town safer. But not only that, it's a direct response to thinking nationally and acting locally. And that was also something that I was always doing. Like going back to Columbine, which was in April of 1999, I was just a patrolman then, but I was concerned that, you know, something like that happened. We weren't properly trained to respond, and we're a small town, and how are we going to respond to something like that? So that was always in the back of my mind. And when I became sergeant in 2005, one of the things that was thrown in my lap was this whole issue of how we're dealing with the traffic issues up at the schools. And I hooked up with Joanne Keating at the time, who was the kind of in charge of security up there. And she had this idea of this mile of safety. And it started out as basically a want, you know, people wanting an officer up there to help monitor traffic and, you know, run the traffic light and monitor speeding cars up there. And it developed into a need to the point where we budget for it, the town budgets for it every year. And it's gotten into an even bigger thing. I mean, we made, you know, more four-way, three-way and four-way stops up there on School Road because of responding to the speeding cars in a 20-mile-an-hour zone. We have a police presence up there. I think it was ultimately the hatchling of the SRO was the mile of safety. People getting used to having officers up on the campus, and then it was more of an accepted idea to have an officer in the school then at that time, which I'm very happy to say that I was the one that appointed the first SRO up at the school, at the high school, Joe McGowan. So I think as you look at what I was able to accomplish over a 10-year period, and again, I didn't do it alone. You know, it was my ideas that I was able to translate into plain English to the police commission, why it was important to get it, and then be able to translate it into, I guess what you would say, a mathematical equation, why the town needs to find a way to afford it. And it's, we have what we have now. I think we have a much safer town since I took it over from Chief Land. I think the town was a lot safer once Chief Land was there for a while after he took it over from Chief McAleenan. And I think it was a safer town once Chief McAleenan took it over from resident state trooper. But again, it's trying to follow the trends and the crimes and keep up to date with training and keep up to date with equipment and all of those things. And I believe that this next chief, I'm thinking, if he's got the philosophy that people have, I mean, I know the state police responded to Sandy Hook. The state police helped us with our investigation on the Maven case and helped us with an investigation on a recent home invasion. So I'm sure that he's aware of Weston, and I'm sure that he, from his point of view, and I'm hoping that he will be able to bring what he's learned as a state police commander to a small town of Weston and keep moving forward and continue to make the town a safer place.
Same kind of question about you personally. Talk about how the work affects you as a person. You talked about compartmentalization and having to deal with that. Nevertheless, the compartments, as you suggested, get full and spill over. Mm-hmm. And maybe you want to share a little bit about that. But really what it comes down to is, what did you learn about yourself as John Troxell, as a person?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think retirement is one of those things that it happens. It's funny because I was talking to my parents about this. When I first started as a police officer, my father was always telling me, you got to get a job where you have medical benefits and you have a pension that you can start putting money into so you can retire someday when you're in your 60s. And I was like, you know, you're 22, 23 years old, and you're like, retirement? What the? I'm going to be this age forever. I'm never going to be 60 years old.
Right.
you know. So the whole retirement thing, I mean, I think in some ways I think that I got a push, you know, from things, things that I had to experience. The Navin case, I think, for me, was probably one of the things that I had to compartmentalize and put on my shelf that started being almost the straw that broke the camel's back. And then the home invasion that happened, where, you know, we have, here we are, you know, I don't want to sound like, you know, not politically correct, but, you know, we've got pretty much a lily white town here, a lily white police department, and the police departments that responded to that were all pretty much lily white. And there were three suspects that were all young black men. And the thing that, everything turned out great. Nobody got hurt, apprehended the three individuals. The people at the house didn't get hurt. But, you know, we really had a real potential here to be either a Cheshire incident or a Ferguson incident or a combination of the two in this small town in this day and age. So I think that I can really say that what helped us with that was the train, the proper equipment, number one, but the training that goes along with it. But also hiring the right people to be police officers in this town and the surrounding towns. What I talked about, the requirements for training, the expectations of the people that come on as police officers from when I started to now, there are a lot more hurdles to get over to become a police officer. And we live in Fairfield County, which Fairfield County towns can afford to give their officers higher salaries so you can attract the best people. So compared to some of these other areas in the nation. So I think that what saved us on that was we had the right equipment, the right training, and the best people responding to that call. And as a result, it turned out fine. But I think that was one of the things that really, that was another thing that I was able to put on my shelf. But again, it's like, wow, are we going to find room for this one, you know? And so you just kind of know when it's time to go. And I won't go into grave details, but my doctor was suggesting for a couple of years that maybe I need to change, you know, what I do for a living because of my certain ailments that I had that have sort of disappeared since I retired.
When it stops being fun. Yeah. That's what she said. That's
and it wasn't fun for me anymore. Literally,
that's what she said.
You know, and there were other things going on that, you know, were other indicators that maybe I should take a hike and hand the torch to somebody else. So it was just time. So and I have, again, I have no regrets. I do still owe the town a huge debt of gratitude. I will always be an advocate for the safety of this town. And I will always be an advocate for the police officers and the police department in this town. Politicians come and go, but we have a really good array of police officers that are young that hopefully will stay here as long as I did. Because you want people to stay. You don't want strangers coming in every few years like some of these departments. You want people to come here and you want them to stay. So if that costs money, I'm a taxpayer now, I say spend the money. You know, keep these people here.
36 years is a long time. Very long time. I don't think that there's anything we haven't talked about.
Yeah, is there a question that we should be asking that we haven't, John?
I think in closing, I would just say, I think I touched on this before, I think that any police officer, any chief of police, anyone who's in the police profession, you got to remember they're all human beings, myself included. So I think that you talked about legacy before. I think that everyone's goal when they retire is that, you know, mistakes will be made. Okay, I've made mistakes, but I hope that my accomplishments and things that I've been able to accomplish for the safety of this town will outweigh mistakes that I've made, and that's what I'll be remembered for. And I'm hoping that. But again, me completely, you know, kind of severing myself from that, I think was important to me. And trying to, you know, kind of, for a little while I felt like I was kind of adrift after I retired. But I think I was adrift heading in a direction. And I still want to be part of the community. I'm going to be here for the foreseeable future. I love this town. And again, I know it's the safest town to be living in right now. You know, what's safer than Weston? And I appreciate, you know, the people that go in and, you know, get on these boards and they don't get paid anything. I think it's a thankless job. And they have a job to do too, especially people on the police commission. And they don't get paid. And they spend a lot of time and effort, you know, negotiating contracts, hiring, promoting, you know, helping with the budget. And I wouldn't be interested in doing any of that stuff. So I appreciate the people that are doing it. I appreciate the people that are on the selectmen's board. I appreciate the people that are on the board of finance. I appreciate people that are on the school board. I'm just glad I was able to interact with them in all of a positive way. I think bottom line is we were a team effort. And we didn't always agree on everything, but I think ultimately we agreed on the things that make the town and the school system and everything safer for the people. And people ultimately want to move here, hopefully, because of it.
Well, thank you, John.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I appreciate the opportunity to sit here with you people. And hopefully people watching this 30 years from now will get a better understanding of what it was like in Weston way back in the dark ages in 2017.